You're in Los Angeles, California. You're a pro. Nobody is supposed to call you. Nobody needs to call you. You didn't get here by being a dickhead. You're a pro.
Dickhead.
Kind of got here by being a dickhead. I mean, in some way.
A lot's happened since yesterday.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a wonderful, special, huge episode of A Lot's Happened Since Yesterday. Ralph, if I were to have a Mount Rushmore of my career, and I've mentioned this earlier before we started, but if I were to have a Mount Rushmore of my career, this crazy bastard would 100% probably be the first one. He'd be on the far left. That's not an age joke. It's just facts. It's just chronological, brother. Mr. Mark Thompson of the Mark and Brian radio podcast or show podcast. Holy shit. Radio show.
We're actually both.
Yeah. Oh, no, that's true, huh? And toward everything the end, yeah. Else, the legend, the radio god, the RG himself. Mark, it is so nice to meet you.
Dude, nice of you to say. You had me at RG because when you when you reached out with your email, you threw in RG is the way. I was in at that point. and you know, I responded to you. You know, we've never met, but I responded to you, dude. I love to talk. So we're going to have a good time today. We're going to talk about some, you know, some fun stuff, but also we're going to get down and talk about some very, very cool things that only people that are of the creative ilk are going to maybe understand, but primarily appreciate. But I do think that there is a misconception as to what a creative is and what it's like. Because some look at it as a curse. The bottom line of it is, and we'll get into this later. I'm not trying to guide this to that. But the bottom line is, if you are a creative, you don't have a choice. You have to do it. And if you don't, things get weird. And so people don't kind of understand the creative process. But I do want to talk about it because it's something that I suffer from and enjoy completely. And yeah, it's a full conversation that I do want to have because I love not only the complexity of it, but I love the simplicity of creative. And so those of you that are out there, you may even be a creative and you don't know it. A light bulb will go off today because we're going to get into it. You got three guys that love to just create shit.
Yeah, it really is. I don't think I could have said it better because it isn't a, it really, after a while, you realize it isn't a choice, huh? You can't not do it.
Well, if you do begin to think that it's a choice, then you're mistaken. A creative is a person who is riddled with the need to do it. And it can be, luckily, it can be any form. Like you guys are based in music and some other stuff. But your creative form can come out in all kinds of ways. Like when I left Mark and Brian, when my broadcast career was for the most part done, I had, and it never goes away, the need to create. And I discovered through, of all things, Bob Ross on YouTube. I discovered painting. I watched him for years for various reasons. And then I decided, I'm going to give it a shot. And what makes a creative different than somebody else is I was watching him paint and I thought, well, I got this. So I get the canvases and the brushes and the paint and I started doing it. And the first thing I did, there was a couple of things that were okay, but most of it sucked. And I'm looking at it and I'm thinking, well, why don't my trees look like Bob? Why don't my bushes look like Bob? And a creative is challenged at that point because you're then riddled with the question, why don't my shrubs look like his? And so
your trees aren't happy.
They're not. And you really start to look at what you're doing creatively and you figure out, oh God, I see what he did. And then you do. And then there it is. Creatives love the process of working something out. Because really what it boils down to at the end of the day, creative people, it's satisfying yourself, not anybody else. And when it's good, when the creative really comes together and brings up something that is unique to them, it's like a drug, better than any drug. It's a little bitty dose of whatever it is that you need. And that's why we do what we do. It can be music, it can be video, it can be a script, it can be painting, it can be radio, podcast, it can be anything. As long as you're being creative, you're satisfying your need, your God-given need to do it.
And do you think that applies to the talent ratio? You know what I'm saying? If you're going to be a creative, do you need to have a certain amount of skill set?
No. Not at all. I will tell you a life lesson of mine that I've learned. I wasn't born with it, but I'll say this, and this files into the area that you're getting into, Ralph. If you want to be good at something, do it. You can read about it, you can take classes, you can talk about it, but if you want to do anything, do it. Because the greatest gift we're given are mistakes. Like you pick up a guitar, you want to play it, and you start kind of doing it, and a couple of things are okay, but some of it's not. And you keep going, you make mistakes, and you realize you break it down and you look at it and you go, that didn't sound the way it should. And you keep doing it until it does sound the way it should. So look, I can tell you this from the career. I took a lot of acting classes and loved them. And I can tell you that from day one, when a new student would come in and would do their first work, I could tell whether they were going to make it or not. Because with acting, you do have to have that inherent something in here to get it. Now, I saw a lot of students come in that were raw and it wasn't real good, but you could see the basic part of what an actor has to have, which is the ability to act truthfully in the imaginary circumstance. And so I could see that in people, though they weren't very good. And then I could also see in most people that they don't have it. It's never going to work. It doesn't matter how hard you try.
So what is the it, do you think? Like good Lord, with your career, you've been involved with so many creators of all separates. I mean, all the movie stars, musicians you've interviewed, everybody. What is there a one thing that you would say that is consistent with most of them, if not all of them, that you've noticed that is like, there it is. That's the one characteristic that you need to have. And to complicate the question anymore, is it harvestable? Can you make it? Or do you just, is it in you when you have it? Well,
he just said it's not. He said you either have it or you don't.
Oh,
which I kind
that
of
part.
Agree with. Yeah. It's like a diamond in the rough kind of thing. I don't want to take too much away from what you asked, Cody. Go ahead.
No, not at all, dude. It's fine.
Go ahead and answer that, Mark.
He said it's not a miss. I missed it.
Well, I'll say this. I did a guy much like you, Cody, reached out and asked me to do a thing. He's a teacher. Mm-hmm. And he teaches a school of rock. And his students are from 6th grade to 12th, and it's a music school, or at least the class was. And I was speaking to them, and he asked me, is there anything that you would like to pass along to the kids that they might benefit from? And I said, yeah. And this is so important, God, we've heard it and heard it and heard it until we're sick of hearing it, but it's so true. The it is within you, and that is you have to choose what it is that you really want to do, not what your mom wants or your dad wants or your friends want or your whatever. You have to pick something that you love, because if you love it, you will succeed. You won't even be able to stop it. Because I got to tell you, I told you radio was really where it started for me as a creative. I could be sitting out, even now, I only do one podcast a week now. I could be sitting outside having a cigar, looking at the lake, enjoying the afternoon. And then an idea of something that I think might be fun to do on the podcast, I will immediately put down the cigar, get up, come into the studio, and start working on it. And I'll look up and I've spent 3 hours. And I didn't even realize how long I'd been here, but in front of me is this great piece of podcast audio that I'm going to do. And I can't wait to do it. And I'm excited to do it. When you love what you've chosen, when you truly dig it, success is going to come. You can't stop it. That's why certain people are great at what they do. And certain people are just getting by because they don't. And I've always felt bad for people that got stuck in a job because the money was pretty good. Maybe it was union. They get married. They have 2.3 kids. They're paying a mortgage, but they hate their fucking job. But they're stuck. They got a house to pay for and kids to feed, and they're stuck. Look, when I first got into radio, I starved. I lived in closets, which I didn't care because I spent all my time at the radio station. I only slept there, but I didn't care. I don't live in closets anymore. I've got it good. And I got to be honest, I am no happier today than I was when I lived in those closets, because when I left that closet, I got to go talk on the radio. Everything else was great. So pick what you love. And if you love it, I can do it,
yeah.
Period. And you will be good at it.
Because in that sense, like you, for you, you found what made you feel the most you. So it wasn't, you know, when people, me and Roth got into this conversation the other day. If you take a young person, you know, when we were young, when we were kids, we started in music. You know, I started playing guitar when I was 11. If somebody would have looked at me and said, look, dude, you're going to play at 11 and then you're going to go through 20 years of work and practice and doubt and no shows and finding people. And even then, you're going to be mediocre compared to what people think you should be, you know. And if you put that kind of idea in front of somebody right off the bat, they're going to go, well, fuck that. You know, anybody who gets into a career they say they love later on, they don't consider it most of the time the long term. They just go, I love this. I want to do it. And you go, like you just said, you loved radio. It wasn't that you were in a closet. It was that you got to go do radio. The idea was being able to create, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we just lost Eddie Van Halen. You can't tell me that Eddie Van Halen wasn't meant to do what he did. You can't tell me that from the moment Eddie got his first guitar, that he didn't sit with it 24 hours a day and play and play and play. And he did that not because he decided that he wanted to be great. He did it because he didn't have any choice. He wanted to master it. He loved it dearly.
Yeah.
And that is essentially what I'm talking about with this. You know, somebody asked me an interesting question because I've mentioned on the podcast that I paint. And a listener asked me, do you paint for the idea that other people will like what you're painting, or do you paint for yourself? I paint for me. Any creative does what they do for themselves, or at least you have to. If you're trying to create stuff in the hopes that somebody else is going to dig you for it, wrong. You have to do things just for you, and be satisfied with the end result of whatever it is. I can tell you, I've written so many movie scripts that it took me minimum a year to write each one. And you have to be okay when you're putting that year of your time into it. You have to be okay with knowing that you're probably going to be the only one that will ever read it. So that's what creative start real simply. They take a pen and a piece of paper. They just start doodling. They just start drawing. And you're the only one who's going to see that. But so then why are you doing it? You're doing it because you have to. So create to make you happy. It was a real light bulb moment for me in my broadcasting career when I realized that I'm not supposed to be preparing a radio show in hopes that other people are going to listen to it and like it. I started preparing radio shows for me. If I were driving down the road listening to the radio, this is the show I would want to hear. And what makes that pure is that what you're doing is you're creating a like-minded situation. If I put on a radio show every day that I love, you're going to be able to tell that I fucking love this show, this crap that I'm doing. And if you like it, then you're going to come back tomorrow. And I'm going to give you the same kind of stupid shit I did yesterday because I love this. So you have to create for yourself, not other people.
That's actually
a very good point.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because in going in it with that mentality, then, you know, the dreaded, you brought up, you know, you get told no and rejected so many times in this business. You know, if you go at it with that mentality, though, the no's are absolutely irrelevant because you're not looking for no's or yeses. You're creating looking for your community because, you know, they're out there. I mean, 7 billion people or some shit in the universe, you know, or in the world. There's tons of people who are going to like what you do. So it's less about trying to be the millionaire success and more about find the people who like what you do and build that and harvest it and reach out to that. Right.
Yeah. And you brought up money. You know, if you launch into a career in the hopes of becoming a millionaire, that's your goal. Yep. You'll never make it. When I got into radio, I made less than a little, and I had no idea that you could ever make real money in radio because I didn't care. It wasn't why I did it. And obviously money came and success came, but the real thing every day for me was it a good show? Did I throw out every morning that I would sit down with the Mark and Brian show or whatever show I did every morning, I had in my satchel 5 or 6 things that I was going to do that day that I knew was gonna fucking kill. I knew it and I couldn't wait. I was like, you know, I had scheduled the first one at 7:40. I was like a kid. It's 7:35. I got 5 minutes. I get to do it. and that's really kind of it. It is what it is. But like I say, if you choose something that you love, you will succeed at it no matter what it is.
So I don't know how to, then what is it about the radio that drove you? Because, I mean, like you said, it is more of the content in that sense, because you're walking into a room talking into a microphone and you got no idea who's listening on the other side. So it really is creating for yourself in that sense. Yeah.
Yeah. We can talk about a couple of things. First of all, the beginning was when I was a kid. I lived in a little bitty town. It was gorgeous, gorgeous, which you don't realize until you leave it. And then you come back and you realize it was a gorgeous place to live. But when I was a kid, it was a great childhood, but something must have been missing because I loved going to the movie. It wasn't a choice of which movie, it was that you're going to the movie. We had one theater and I would watch whatever the movie was. I would take the ride the director wanted me to, because it was a place I had never been on the screen and I dug it. The closest for me was the local radio station, WOWL. They had great jocks. I loved them. I would ride my bike up there and hang out in the lobby and in the hopes of meeting one of them. Cause I listened all day, every day. And, my favorite was a jock named Christopher J. Ballou. He did afternoons. He was a fucking wild man, a hellion. The jocks would party on the weekend. He got too drunk one weekend and dumped concrete in the PD's trunk. And he got suspended, but not before he told the story. He was my hero. And so then they started advertising that Christopher, I'd never met him, was going to broadcast from a shopping center a couple of miles from my house. I rode my bike up and there he was. And I started walking up to him. I'm 10. I walked up to him. He looked at me. He saw me. He smiled. And he said, "Don't bump the record, kid." Because they actually played the records from the location there. 6 years later, I couldn't have known it, but I would become a jock at WOWL and would work alongside Christopher J. Ballou. And it was everything about it for me. I'm now losing my point as to what the initial question was.
I don't know, because I'm losing myself in the story. Oh, no. Well, what I was going to say was you were speaking about the creation aspect of things, and we were just alluding to the fact that you started by walking into a room by yourself and speaking to just nobody and really just honing your craft that way.
Yeah, so two things. So once I got into radio, mm-hmm. I had listened to all the local radio stations. There was a box of tapes in the production room. I spent all my time at the radio station because I could. I listened to the tapes and it was air checks of major market radio stations.
What's an air check?
Air check is a scoped tape of a radio station or a jock. They cut out all the commercials and all of the record, and you just hear the jock.
Got it.
So it could be 3 minutes, which was an entire show. And I listened to this major market tape, 10Q, KABC, WABC. They sounded so good. The jocks were just like I had never heard anything like that. And I was 16, and that was it. I wanted to become that. I want to be that guy. I want to make it to major market. And I knew that the only way to get there was to leave my hometown and climb the ladder. I made a goal. Every new job that I took would be a larger market, so another step up the ladder and a little bit more money. I never broke that rule. And, you know, my analogy was simple, but yet smart at 16. If I climb the ladder one rung at a time, eventually I'll just land in major market. They can't stop me. And it worked. I made it to LA. So, it for me, it was that light bulb moment of this is what I want. It took me 15 years to get there, but I never wavered. I never stopped. I would air check. I'd take a boombox. A boombox is a big cassette player with speakers on it.
And the cassette I'm just kidding.
It's true, though. Yeah, I mean, you got to answer.
It's ridiculous, huh?
And so every day, right before I did a talk break, I would push record and record my entire show. I did this for years. And on the drive home, I would listen back to my entire show.
Oh, damn.
And stuff that was good, I knew it when I did it, that it was good. But the stuff that was bad, like I took a phone call and I'm listening to it on the drive home and I'm going, Jesus Christ, why don't I stay on the fucking phone for 8 years that you should have dumped out of this 5 minutes ago? What are you doing? I learned what not to do more than I learned what to do. But the point is, I never gave up on the drive to do it, to get better, to hone it, to do it better. And I got cocky with it. I knew this is not cocky. Cocky is when you talk shit, but you can't back it up. I knew. Boys, when I drove my U-Haul into a new town and I was going to take over afternoon on Monday, I knew that Monday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, when I hit the air, there was nobody that could touch me. And I couldn't wait for the shock on their face when they heard what I fucking got. And it was an addiction. It was the creative. It was the whole thing all balled up into one. And it was a drug. And I loved being good at what I did. And I worked at it so very hard. Success is a double-edged sword. You make it to a point that you strive to get to. And then when you get there, and I say this because it's important, when you get there, wherever it is that you wanted to be, it's never what you thought it was going to be. There's all kinds of minutia. There's all kinds of shit around you that tries to get in your way. And I learned a big lesson, and I want to share this with both of you because I think you may could use it. When I got to the top, when we were big, when Mark and Brian were just on fire, everybody wanted to meet with us about television, and they wanted this, and they wanted that. Jerry Reed said it in the 70s with a great song, when you're hot, you're hot. When you're not, you're not.
Thanks.
And when you're hot, you're fucking hot. Everybody wanted a chunk. And we were being pulled in so many different ways at so many different times that it can take away from you doing what got you here. Are you with me so far?
Facts.
Mm-hmm.
What I learned was it doesn't matter what all goes on the side. If you take care of what got you there, which for me was whatever came out of the speakers in the morning, if you take care of that, all this other shit on the side, all this distraction, all this white noise, it's not going to matter. You take care of what got you there and you'll be good. Take care of the white noise if you can, but take care of what got you there. And that should be your number one main focus.
Oh, I thought you were going to say something, Ralph. I thought you were getting ready
to. Well, no, I was going to say that sounds like, you know, like an amazing piece of information that some people may not have thought of, but it also sounds like truth to me. And At the same time, though, I wonder, do you feel that, because this is something that I've thought about for many, many years throughout my life. I believe that passion and having, you know, a drive like you were talking about, I think that's number one. I think that's like the number one thing. You have to be very driven. You have to be beyond driven in order to get accomplished what you're seeking to accomplish. And if you're driven by something, it's because you're so passionate about it and you love it. So I agree with you 100% on that. But let me ask you this, Mark, do you think that circumstances maybe have something to do with whether or not someone is able to accomplish their goals and their dreams?
I'll share with you something that a conversation I had with my son's wife that would make her my daughter-in-law. She's a musician. And she spends a lot of her time recording, writing. She's a singer, education, got a degree in it. And she reached out to me. She had a conversation. She was concerned about the fact that she wasn't where she wanted to be in her career, in her music. And she was asking my advice as to what to do. And I told her, I said, look, it kind of falls in line with all the stuff that we've already talked about. I said, look, you can't get caught up in that you don't have the hit record yet. You don't have the number one smash on Billboard. You just have to create and put out stuff that you're digging. And you have to be okay with that while continuing to work at it and do what you do. And she's really good, but a lot of people are. One of the other conversations that I had with her was that because she was concerned, you know, she doesn't get to spend a lot of time with the creative because she has to pay the bills. And this is very important. Really, really important. It falls in line with Ralph's question. While you chase your dream, while you go after what it is that you want to do, there is a fact in life. And that is you've got to pay for your roof and your clothes and your food. You got to pay for your life. So hopefully you're making a little bit of money with what it is, your creative ploy that you've chosen. Hopefully you're making a little bit there, but if you're not, you have to make it somewhere else. You got to pay for your life. That's just what it is. And so you have to find a way to combine the two. And I don't know of anybody who's successful that didn't schlep it. You know, I've got a buddy who's chasing a dream. He's got a real job. I won't get into what it is. But now, after he goes and does his real job, he then goes and schleps delivering food. He's got kids at home. He's delivering food to people's homes. And then he goes and works. He goes home, kisses the kids goodnight. Then he works on his creative. And then he gets up and he does his job. He's doing the deal. He's raising a living while chasing his dream. And so, yes, there's a ton of shit that'll get in your way. And you're going to be challenged as you chase what it is that you want to try to get to, where, you know, you get to a point where it's a little too tough and you give it up. And that's your choice. But there will always be things to get in your way. That's part of the joy when you make it.
The heart.
Have you heard of the?
Go ahead. The heart is what makes it great. You know, if it's easy, Everybody be doing it.
Just going to say, Mark made a real good point, and all I wanted to add to that and ask Mark is, have you ever heard of the term "burn the boats"?
No, tell me.
I guess it's based on. I think it was.
It was the guy who was. Was it? Was it the Fountain of Youth?
Was it the Second World War though?
Was it
that it was based on where they invaded Germany and they went in, you know, they went in to fight them in boats. I understand that's what it was, and that
keep telling the story, and I will confirm the origins as you're talking. Go ahead.
They went to fight the Germans and they went in, you know, in boats, and when they went for this, I think it was. Trying to remember the name of the battle, but anyways, they were overrun, but But supposedly the thought in their mind, I don't know if they actually did it, but they were like, they're at the point of no return. So burning the boats mean that there was no way for them to turn back. Mm. They had to burn their boats and go fight.
Yeah.
Do the battle. So yeah. I guess that's my point is, do you believe that that is something that you have to face at some point in your life when you're looking to make that move to become a creative, you know, where you're looking to take it to the next level? Do you have to burn the boats at some point, or can you still do this balancing act? You know,
I can answer that question by giving you a true story. I was, as I told you, just out of high school. Making nothing, but I loved it because I was on the radio and I ran into a buddy, and my buddy had a brand new car. He just bought a brand new home. And I said, dude, what are you doing? And he goes, there was a Reynolds aluminum plant in my hometown and he was working there. It's a union job and he's working at Reynolds aluminum, a job that he hated. But he was making like 70 grand a year. And I'm not making 70 cents a week. And he said to me, dude, I can get you in. I mean, I can get you in. 70, boom. And for like a weekend, I thought about it because I could have a brand new car and I could have a nice house. Oh, wait, I won't be able to talk on the radio. And I didn't do it. You know, as to your burn the boat thing, honestly, that is a personal question. That's up to you. But, you know, I just think that anybody, and you look at any of them, Bruce Springsteen, Elvis Presley, James Dean, Marlon Brando, whoever it was, they did what they had to do to get to do what they did. One of the things that I've learned, and if you look at any of the arts, whether it's theater, film, book, novels, acting, music. And you cannot get around this fact. When something is good, it's because if you dig down into it, if it's really good, whatever it is, if you peel back the layers and you look at the very nucleus, the center of it, it's real, it's honest. And the audience, sadly, the audience knows when it's real, when it's honest. And this is the negative part, they also know when it isn't. So whatever it is that you're doing, as long as you mean it, as long as you're being truthful and honest to yourself, it's got a good shot at going. Because the audience digs that. I heard a story just this morning when I was doing the podcast. You can judge. You guys are rockers and you got your, probably metal. But I've always enjoyed Journey, Steve Perry led Journey. I've always enjoyed that. And like the song or not, faithfully, it was played at every wedding and every high school prom everywhere, faithfully by Journey. Jonathan Cain, the keyboard player, told the story this morning. He had been on the road, you know, not making any money, not doing anything. He was fighting with his wife. He was on tour, had been on tour for months. He lands in New York, climbs off the bus, falls dead asleep. His wife is about to join. They're fighting left and right. She doesn't want to come on tour. He wants her on tour because he loves her. He wants to see her. He wakes up and he had a germ of an idea. And he had a keyboard in the hotel room and he's just wrecked. He's so exhausted, but he took the angst of his wife joining him on tour and the fact that she didn't want to be there, but he wanted her there. But he really wanted her there faithfully. He sat down and he wrote it on a paper bag, 9 minutes, good and faithfully God. Was born. And that you hear that and you realize that was for him. He didn't care what anybody thought about the shit he was writing on this brown paper bag, and he's so tired he can't read the words, and it became a multi-billion dollar seller. But he wasn't thinking about that. He was writing about the angst he felt about where he was in his life. He hadn't made it. His wife hates him, doesn't want to be with him. He wants to fucking kill himself. And I think I'll write a song. And you don't ever know where it's going to come from. But in that moment, he meant it. He was being truthful. He was being honest. And the, as I told you, the audience knows when you mean it and they know when you don't.
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like you're talking about, you know, my kind of music and my kind of artist, but how do you explain pop? No, I'm just kidding. But anyway.
The thing is, honestly, I think pop is, I mean, music is music, dude. At some point, regardless of, Mark is 100% right, but there is, you do it for you, but there are people who get off on knowing how to write a selling song. Like, that's their thing. So they have dedicated their time to learning how to follow trends and learning how to follow that kind of demographics and go, no, these are the aspects of things. I'll analyze this music and continue with the trend.
Look, I'll say this. I spent a lot of years radio-wise in top 40, which we played a lot of pop. And pop is, and you cannot argue this point, pop is the biggest genre of music in the world.
Absolutely.
Can't stop it, can't control it. Now, because it's the biggest, it's the largest money maker. And what Cody just said is true. A lot of people have jumped on that bandwagon and perfected the craft of building pop music because they're making trillions of dollars. What is this Korean band? Is it BTS?
BTS. My daughter loves that band.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Is that K-pop or whatever?
Yeah. All right. Now dig this now. Whatever. Dig this. I mean, this is a lesson because K-pop, BTS is corporate. There is a corporation that brings these kids in when they're like six and they live at the compound and their parents want them there. Because there's money and they're trained how to dance, how to sing, how to walk, how to talk. They're built. They're like robots. And so when one of the guys of BTS, his voice changes or he starts to grow facial hair, they kick him out and they just bring in a new one. Now, the kids are making a decent check, but they don't own anything. The corporation owns it, yeah. And it is multi trillions of dollars in pop. So, you know, I watched the one video and when it first came out because it went globally number one within seconds. And so I watched the video and it was pleasing, but I didn't ever need to see it again, is the thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's nice while you're looking. It's like a Hershey bar. It tastes good going in. I'm not going to remember eating it. But you can't fault pop for being what it is. It is bubble gum. Yep. You chew it, you spit it out, and you're done. And then you got the better stuff. Well, I don't want to say better.
Stuff.
But you've got, you know, the deeper stuff as a fan once, because I was making fun of Neil Young on the show and he calls up and he goes, let me tell you something, fuckhead. Neil Young doesn't sing because he wants to. Neil Young sings because he has to. I said, okay, listen, you're a fan, but let's put on some BTS. What do you say? It's just kind of what it is. And that's why I love music. People, like when I first went to work at KLOS, which was classic rock, and I came from top 40. I was not used to the fan base and the jocks that are so dedicated to the music. They don't even speak over the top of it or the end of it because it's religious. It should not be touched. And the very first day that Mark and Brian got on the air, we played a Neil Young song and we, within 30 seconds, we went, this is our first day on the air. We go, what is this crap? And I grabbed the needle and raked it across the album. And I said, nah, we're not playing this. We're going to put on some good music. And we put on Glenn Campbell, Southern Nights. The phones exploded.
Oh,
they were so,
God.
Oh, they were so pissed off. We put the phone calls on the air and it was hysterical. We, by doing that, we went against the grain. Why? Because number one, we thought it was funny. But most importantly, we meant it. Neil Young, to our ears, sucked. Glenn Campbell was better. And the audience knew we meant it. But at the same time, we didn't do anything maliciously. We put the phone calls on the air. We had fun with the people. And the one thing that I learned in radio is that it doesn't matter how good you are. When you take a new job and you go on the air day one, you, because of the fact that you are not the guy that you replaced, you're the most hated guy in the city.
Right.
And the best thing to do is air those phone calls, let them know that you don't give a shit what they think, and then they dig you. So, yeah, music is music. I can't explain pop other than to tell you that the people who are in it, their pockets are overflowing, my friend.
I was just going to say, like, you can't blame them. I mean, if you could tap into that as an artist, you know.
Sure.
I mean, at the end of the day, I'll say it right now. You're right, Mark. We are rock and metal guys at heart. But if I could use or get into the place where I have colleagues who are going, dude, just write me a song and I'll sell it, and then you can continue to do what you're doing.
Sure.
You fucking kidding me? I do it in a heartbeat.
Somebody give me Katy Perry's number.
I will write fucking E.T. every day if that's what it takes.
Now, I don't know if you guys have seen it, but I highly recommend it. Hired Gun, the documentary. Have you seen it
yet?
Yes, I have. Okay.
All right. With the session players, right?
Yeah. There is a thing, Hillary Duff. All right. Now, primarily, this particular section of the documentary is about the metal guys. They came from Judas Priest and all over. And Hillary Duff was about to go on a world tour. And Hillary is pop to the hilt. But for some reason, Hillary, as she was putting together the tour band, she told her manager, I want metal guys. I want guys who have played metal. I want them to play metal. I want them to dress it. I want them to do the whole thing. So they went out and hired a bunch of guys that were hired guns for metal bands to come in and play for Hillary Duff. And they were all like, fuck that bullshit. And then they heard how much. And it was beyond scale. It was crazy money. And they started to, you know, they showed up, they did it. And then they started talking about, you know, dude, when I was with these other bands, we were doing grungy clubs, happy to have a half a house. We were playing to 60,000 kids a night in a stadium making crazy money. And they were digging the shit out of us. I loved it. And then even when Hillary went on break, they continued to get paid full. Listen, if it puts money in the bank, I don't care what you think of it. Look at the paycheck. Mm-hmm. You cash, you put that away, and it goes back to what we talked about. You got to pay the bills. You write that pop song for whoever it is, and you're good for a year where you don't have to worry about paying the rent while you do what you love to do.
And those aspects of things are in all of the industries, really. I mean, you even hear about, you know, there's actors who'll go, I do one for the paycheck, I do one for the art, and that's their career. They just flip-flop because, hey, I can do it. And if somebody in the art world can use their skill to make a fuck ton of money, there is no word, in my opinion, the word sellout. And it drives me crazy with that shit because, honestly, if you're an artist and you've taken a job, like you said, I got to pay bills, so you're goddamn right I did this job for the money. I needed it. But I stayed in my industry. I didn't, you know, I did everything I can to stay where I wanted to be. You know,
we had on Mark and Brian, we had Ray Liotta. Mm-hmm. And this is maybe a year after Goodfellas. And so he was really hot property. And so we were chatting. This was off the air during a commercial break. I'm talking to him. And I'm not sure how we got into it. And I said, where do you live? I live in the Valley. And I said, really? I kind of thought you'd be a Beverly Hills guy. And he goes, well, first of all, I'm not a Beverly Hills guy. He said, but I purposely live way below my means because I don't want to be burdened with a massive mortgage or a bunch of bills because I don't want to have to do a piece of shit so I can pay for a house.
That's smart.
I want to be able to say yes or no to whatever I want. Thought it was really, really smart on his part. And it falls into kind of what you're talking about.
Well, it makes sense. And when you brought up Hillary Duff, I thought about Miley Ray Cyrus, because she's leaning towards that sound now. She did pop forever, and now she's doing a bunch of rock songs. You know what I mean? I'm seeing covers that she's doing left and right on YouTube, and it's kind of cool. I actually think she sounds good, and I actually think it works for her. I think she's starting to find a passion. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think that's a tough road, you know, for someone like Miley Cyrus. Her dad's a country guy. She comes from a pop career, moving into metal or harder stuff. She has to be careful, because these metal fuckers, they'll rip your heart out if you're not sincere with it. So as long as she comes out with gritty stuff and really means it, and you know what? I think she's got a shot, because life has kicked her around pretty good of the last 5 years. I mean, slapped her.
Yeah.
If she figures out to be really honest with that and say that, she'll make it.
Yeah, because you're right. The metal guys, the metal fans do not like. You don't dabble in metal. You can produce a less than good quality album, and like you said, if you do it with the heart and the love, we'll be behind you. But if you just tiptoeing into the scale, you're going to get crucified for it.
I have to tell you, and this falls into this lesson that we're talking about right now. As I told you, I came from top 40, a lot of pop music.
Right.
The audience is so fluff, they don't care about much. I then moved to classic rock, and now you're talking about metal. When it comes to the heart, like if there's a kid in your community that needs a liver transplant and the family can't afford the $300,000, tell a classic rock fan, tell a metal fan. They will come out of the woodwork to raise money to help this kid get. And why? Because they have heart, they have passion, they mean what they do. And I learned that really, really hard with KLOS. If somebody was in need, these fans of this particular genre of music came from, they had nothing, and they were giving you what they had to help out with this cause. And it touched me the first time I saw it, and it was consistent throughout the 27 years. You need something, you let them know. And I also learned another lesson, which is another story, but remind me to tell you, because it's a valuable lesson that I want to share with you before we go.
Okay, we'll get to it. At what point do you think it becomes, we all can push so far, but at some point it becomes really undeniable that you got to push with a team. You need to get people on your side. You need to push together. Does that make sense? For example, you can, I don't know how to explain it. I'm trying to Ralph and I have been pushing what we considered by ourselves for years, you know, but at some point you find the contacts that believe in you. You find the people who, your community by your side. It's never just you, you know, whether it's the fans or whether it's somebody in the industry that believes in you. At what point is there a point where you have to have that? Or do you think there is a way where it's complete, you can be completely independent with it?
With what?
With success, getting success in your craft. You know, I mean, like I said, if you're going to be in a band, you can be a musician by yourself. You can go out on stage. You can do this stuff. But after a certain while, you're going to probably need a booking agent. You're going to probably need some people that help you get to where you are. You need people on your side that you trust implicitly to help you.
I think that's always good.
Right.
You know, being in connection with people. I my son is a professional drummer. He teaches. He didn't want a tour. And so he chose to teach and stay home. He's an amazing drummer. But the first thing I told him, I said, you got to network. You've got to take your card when you're out and about, you're at a convention, you're at this, you're at that. You got to pass your name around.
Right.
It comes down to who you know. You can be great. I mean, great. And if nobody's seeing it, then they don't know. If you network, you meet the right people, good people. And I promise you to be, or I remind you to be careful with who you trust. But find good people and show them what you do. And if they dig it and they're into it, good thing, only good things can come from that. You know, if you think you're going to pull the sled by yourself, that's a tough go.
Yeah.
But I am a firm, firm believer in networking, getting to know, passing the goodwill. Yeah, people loving people. Yeah, I think it's key. From the get go, I think it's key.
Because there is, it seemed to me that seems there is a contradicting thought process in the industry, and that is the competition aspect of it. And I think if you embrace the opposite end and realize if you're in a band and you can find other bands that play similar music and have a good following and you guys get along, for fuck's sakes, take you all on tour. You know, don't go, we're better than these guys. Fuck them. We're not going to take them on tour because we're better. You know, there is an aspect where when you team up and push together, that builds on each other without taking away from, you know what I mean? There's money to be had everywhere for everybody. And it seems like there is a strong push to go, no, you have to be the best and fuck everybody else. And, you know, you want to be the best for you, in my opinion. And if you can be the best you are, whoever's better than you or worse than you is irrelevant in the sense that you're just doing who you are and what you do. You bring who you can along and everything comes with it.
Yeah. Again, I think if what you're doing is genuine and real, the audience will know it.
Right.
But having certain people in certain places that can help you and benefit you, I say get that from the very beginning. Right. If you got something good, show it to people.
Yeah. Well, you know, before we move on to another topic, I did want to just ask you this because you've been in the business for a long time and I know you've seen a lot of the ins and outs. So is it true that, you know, you can just buy your way there to success? Because it seems like, you know, radio stations, sometimes they'll play people and you're just like, where did these guys come from? And, you know, you're in the community, you're working the Hollywood circle, you're working, you know, all the circles that matter in your music scene, but you don't seem to be getting as far as this person or that person that just got there. It seemed like they got there out of nowhere. And then you find out that maybe they had some money behind them and that's part of the process. And it really, in some cases, doesn't have all that much to do with the product. It has to do with more of like payola, you know, get on the radio. Well, you can get your song on the radio and heard, you know, 5-6 times a day. Is that true? Is that true, Mark? Is that
absolutely
how it works?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. Unfortunately, it's a very real thing. but make no mistake. It's not about the artist. It's about the record company or the movie company. It's about the company. They are the ones that benefit from this particular artist or that particular artist. So if they have to pay somebody over here and then somebody over here and somebody over here to help get this artist where they need it to be, that is, I guess, still the case. I'm pretty sure it is. God knows it always has been. And I'm not talking about just flat out illegal chunks of cash handed to a person. I'm talking about the bigger picture, taking care of a situation that needs to be taken care of so that so-and-so will play this song or so-and-so will record this song or so-and-so will play a lead guitar bit on so-and-so's song so it gets more. Yeah. Unfortunately, that is the case. It always has been. There's politics involved. There's all kinds of, we're talking trillions and trillions of dollars. And make no mistake about it, guys, look, I know you mean it. I know it's your passion. I know you want nothing more. But to get to where you want to be, it's corporate. It's big. Look, why do we continue here to hear the stories about bands from the 60s and 70s and 80s that got signed and had massive hit albums, massive hit records? They couldn't go to the mall with girls screaming and they couldn't afford to pay their fucking rent. And then they looked into the contract and they don't own anything. Look, I have young radio people come up to me and they go, hey, listen, man, you made it. What can I do? I'm a young radio. What can I do? And I always say the same thing. And they look at me like I'm insane, but I mean it. I said, if you're any good, if you're truly any good, get a great attorney. And they stare at me like, what the fuck are you talking about? That protects your interests. You know, if these bands from the six, like the Guess Who, you guys don't know who I'm talking about.
Absolutely do. American Woman. Come on, man.
Yeah. Okay. The Guess Who, owned the 60s and they got robbed. I mean, Randy Bachman left the, when the Guess Who broke up, he started Bachman Turner Overdrive. And the very first hit they had was Taking Care of Business. They were robbed. I mean, nothing. They got nothing. If they had listened to me and gotten a good attorney, they would have never signed that piece of shit contract to begin with. So look, I understand you want to make it, no matter who you are and whatever your job is, but you've got to be realistic. It is a business. It is a corporate world, and you are entering into it. It will benefit you greatly by knowing what the rules are and play the game the same way they play it. Look, when the record company comes in and they've just fed you a lobster dinner and all the wine you want, and there's a couple of good looking girls, and then when you're properly drunk, they pop down the contract they want you to sign. Trust me, it's in their best interest that you sign this piece of paper. Read it first.
To what you were saying with the bullshit, with the contracts and stuff people can fall into, were you guys at all, did you see Dave Chappelle's destroying special just recently? I think it was like 2 days ago.
I have not seen it, but I saw him being interviewed by David Letterman, and I was so blown away by that guy. You know, one of the things that I was talking to Ralph about, where the audience knows if you mean it or not.
Right.
Dave Chappelle fucking means it. It comes from a special place with him. He's a stand-up that's not just telling jokes and being funny. He's laying out life lessons.
Right.
So no, I haven't seen that. I want to see that.
It's on his Instagram. I really, really implore everybody to go watch this, because it literally comments on what you were just talking about. Because it's entitled Unforgiven. Mm. And the entire special, it's 18 minutes long of him telling everybody to basically boycott his show.
That's what I heard.
Yeah, he tells everybody boycott Chappelle's show, mainly because he left out of the show from Comedy Central because it was a raw deal and he didn't want to do it anymore. And now they're just freely using his shit. And so now he's coming out being Dave Chappelle, being the man who he is now. He's just flat coming out going, if you want to use my shit, pay me. You know, you use me out of a bad deal, the whole nine.
I'm completely supportive of that. There's too many artists in every forum that have just been just completely taken advantage of.
Decimated.
And other people benefiting from their gift. Fuck you.
Oh, dude. And when you hear his story, like, you know, they started streaming the Chappelle show on the HBO Max. And that's what set him off. I'm not even going to spoil it. Go watch it. It's 18 minutes. And you will, I'm with pride, say, hashtag boycott Chappelle show. Fuck him. Just like you said. Yeah. And I think one good thing about the internet is we can kind of maybe make things a little level on the playing field for the creatives on that. Because now they don't have the ability 100% to go, well, without us, you're screwed. You know, we have the ability to reach a community and produce our art in a major way without needing one door to get us in, you know, and hopefully that bullshit, like you were talking about with the contracts, maybe that'll stop a little bit, because we have guys like you being able to talk about it freely, like Dave Chappelle coming out and going, fuck these guys, just boycott them until they pay me. And maybe we can get a little bit more level playing field with the artist in terms of this shit, you know?
Well, it's not what it was back in the day, where if you were an artist, a musician, and you wanted to make it, you had to have a band. You had to have a record deal, because the record company would put you in the studio with a session group and you would record your music and they promote it and get it played on the radio. And then they would get rich and you would get nothing. Yeah. These days, musicians and artists can make their product in their living room with Pro Tools or whatever the case may be. So there's ways to get your shit out there. I don't know anything beyond that. I know that at that point it becomes a real grind as to how to get word out.
Right. It's I mean, at the end of the day, it really is. When you're trying to release any kind of, whether it's a single or an album, the internet has just kind of taken the place back in the day where, you know, you hear the stories of the bands. Oh yeah, we had 300 copies of our record in the trunk and we'd go play the show and then sell out the parking lot. You're kind of doing that now on just digitally. You know, the plus side is instead of standing in the parking lot of one bar, you can reach people everywhere. But yeah, it does make the grind that exponentially harder because you're not able to, well, you are able to, but you can just, instead of focusing on your grassroots and working out, they expect you to, your grassroots now is the fucking world. Get out there and make your bones, you know?
I'm the wrong guy to talk. I don't know shit about that. You know, with me and in radio, as I was coming up, it was very pure, really, honestly. You know, like if you're in radio and you are working at a radio station, you've got another radio station you're competing with. Both of you, your station and your competition, you both play the same songs, the same commercials, the same promotions. The one thing that set you apart from that other radio station is the jocks that you put on the air, the personalities, the really good ones. They get the listeners and then you get the ratings in, and then the radio station uses those ratings to get advertising. And that's how you make money. It was very pure. It was simple. Even I could understand it. I got it. It seems really convoluted now, all the stuff you're talking about. So I have no advice into that other than to say, dude, if you mean it, if it's real, if it's honest, somebody, look, I'll tell you this, and this may fall in line. We had Jerry Seinfeld early, Mark and Brian, quite literally in the first year, 87, 88. Jerry Seinfeld is on the show. He was a big comedian, but this is prior to the Seinfeld TV show. And he was on the program and somebody called and said, have you considered doing TV? There's other comedians doing well. And he said, well, yeah, kind of. NBC has signed us to a 4-episode deal. We're in the middle of preparing them now. We're going to shoot them. We don't know what's going to happen. But yeah, we're about to do that. And of course that turned into Seinfeld, the television show. But another comedian called up and he asked Jerry, he said, look, I'm a stand-up and I'm trying to figure out how to get my name out there. How do I network? I need to get a manager. I don't have one. I need to get an agent. I don't have one. And Jerry interrupted him. He said, let me tell you something. If you're a stand-up, you don't need to worry about managers and agents and whatever. Don't just stop worrying about it. Because if you're good, they will find you. And I thought that was great advice. And I think that's true in a lot more than just stand up. If you're really, really good at what you do, and maybe I'm wrong, maybe that was then, maybe now is a different deal. But I do believe that if the product is good, people are going to show up for it.
I agree. I think so. I mean, the word Ralph and I have been bouncing around on the show has been really, it's undeniable. I mean, you have to take charge of what you're doing and go with it with the anger of a goddamn rabid lion, I think.
Well, speaking of that, one of my favorite fucking things in the world, and you talk about creative. Listen to this. An artist, I forget his name. You guys may know. An artist, a painter, and he had said, you know, I paint because I love it. I don't want my stuff sold. I don't want anybody to buy it. And one of his paintings was up for auction. They were going to auction it off. And somebody bought it. They paid like $1 million or $2 million for the painting.
Is this Banksy? Is this Banksy?
It sounds like
it. I think
it's Banksy. Because fucking love this.
Yeah, I know.
I had never heard his name.
Brace yourself, Ralph. This is a great story.
Oh, Ralph. Oh my God. This is the genius of creativity. Listen to the purity. The guy said, I don't want anybody to own my art. They were selling one of his paintings at auction Let's just say it was $2 million. The hammer comes down, $2 million sold. The moment the hammer came down, the painting is on the wall. It started to move. The painting started to move down inside the frame. It was a mini shredder, and it shredded the fucking painting that somebody just paid $2 million for.
In front of now, the entire gallery.
This fucking dude said, I don't want it sold. He went to the trouble to create where you couldn't tell, a shredder inside the frame that shredded what he said he didn't want sold. But what he didn't understand is that that made it worth 100 times more than it initially was.
Yeah, facts.
Oh, oh God. I just admire everything, because that is art. It is honesty, and it is brilliance. Yeah. And it puts the metal fuck you on it. Fuck
yes.
You.
Yeah. And it takes, and dude, the balls that guy had.
It's
to
a
have.
Lot. That's what I was going to say, man. It's a lot of balls. Yeah. It's a lot of balls.
Absolutely.
It's the Queen movie. You got to admit, man, you know, he stuck to his guns. He had a lot of balls. He just said, no, I'm not doing it this way. I'm doing it my way. Yeah. You know what I mean? And so that was another, you know, and I don't know if you ever watched Vinyl on HBO, Mark. Have you watched that? Have you seen that?
I have not. I've heard about it. Haven't seen it. You're digging it?
I would appreciate your viewpoint on that. Even if you were to hit me up at some point and go, hey, Ralph, yeah, I watched it and I thought it was cool. I like this about it, because it was about people behind the scenes in the industry. The people that owned the record label, the people that they dealt with the radio DJs, they dealt with the, what do they call the guy, the program directors, right. You know, they dealt with those guys. They dealt with all kinds of people. And they were dealing with Led Zeppelin and all the huge, mega huge rock stars of back in the day. Mm-hmm. And it's an interesting show.
He says it was
cut short. It's called Vinyl. It was cut short, and I don't know why, because I thought it was a really cool show.
I've heard of it. I've just not seen it yet.
Yeah, but it went into the details of behind the scenes, the payola and all that stuff came up, and I just thought that was interesting, because I know you know about that.
Yeah, well, I was in it, and you know, Ralph, you were asking about that, and I had a quick story. You talk about the machine, it was a situation I went through. We, Mark and Brian, we had a TV show on NBC in 91. And it was about to debut. And the NBC needed us in New York for the launch party at Carnegie Hall for the advertising community. So we said, okay. So we flew into New York. We did the radio show that morning at WPLJ. We were ushered by an NBC person across the street from the radio station into a bank, up to the roof, got on a helicopter, flew across the city, landed on another bank, got out of the helicopter, down the elevator, and now we're going to cross the street into Carnegie Hall, because there's going to be all of the stars of NBC's fall schedule, and we're going to launch the thing. And there was a crowd of people, fans, that wanted our autograph, and we're being moved through the crowd. And I stopped, there was a guy, please, please, the autograph. And I stopped down and I'm signing my autograph on the thing. And the NBC guy grabbed my hand and pulled me away. And he got me inside. So that was a fan I was signing his. He goes, dude, he doesn't even know who the fuck you are. That guy is a professional autograph seller. If you become a star, then he'll sell your autograph for
$5,000. Are you serious?
Yeah. And it just kind of, the whole machine of it kind of came crashing, because it really, sorry to be this, but God damn it, somebody's got to tell you the truth. Everything, and it's because of society. We did it. We did it to ourselves. Everything is about money. Mm-hmm. That's what it comes down to. How much is there? How much of it can I get? And when can I have it? It's true. And you've got to know that if you're a creative and you're about to launch yourself, you got to know what you're going to face. And that is a reality of life. And it just is.
But is there, there are the trick though, I think, do you think it's the trick is finding what the good stuff to spend the money on? You know, for us in our industry, there was a lot of, you know, hey, we can get you this deal. All it takes is $500 or whatever the fuck. And they tell the bands that they think they're going to have this opportunity. And we go, oh, yeah, that's bullshit. We're not paying for that, but we'll invest in X, Y, and Z. You know what I mean? Navigating that becomes an issue, right?
Well, I really think as far as if you're a creative, if you're an artist, an actor, a musician, a writer, whatever, and you just have the need to do this, you really need to spend some time with yourself and ask yourself, what do I want? What do I want from this? Let's say I'm an actor and I'm really, really good, but I don't care about success. I just want to do it. All right. Let's see if you mean that. Do dinner theater in your town. Just do that. Because you're acting, you don't need success, you don't need the money, you don't care, you said, about the money,
right?
You don't care about the fame, you don't care about the adulation that comes with it. You said you don't care, so just go do local theater and you're good. Bullshit. I say bullshit.
Yeah.
Who wouldn't like to have the mansion? Who doesn't want the nice car? Who doesn't want to take a European vacation? You have to be upfront with you. What do you want? What do you need? And then find out what the game is. If you want the mansion and the Porsche and the European vacation, find out what the game is. Figure it out. What are the rules? Learn how to play and fucking play. And just know that when you're stepping in there with the big boys, if you actually get that far, they're real good at what they do. Be as good as them. And so it really comes down to a real heart to heart. What do you want? You don't have to tell anybody what their answer is, but what do you want? What do you need from this? And go get that.
And that's one of the hardest questions to come to terms with for yourself, honestly.
Yeah.
It's a workload.
It is, but I think you really benefit. You really look, one of the things, the great things about coming up the radio ladder is that I learned a lot along the way. You can never replace experience. You can't buy it. You can't rent it. You just go through it. And the experience of what I was climbing into was every day, the stuff that I learned. So when I got there, it wasn't a shock. I'm being honest in telling you, I never wanted money. I didn't know that you could make money. I wanted to be one of the best. That's what I wanted. And see, the good news up, I didn't need anybody to say yes to me to get that. I could get that. It's a different game when you need somebody to say yes. That's tough.
Yeah.
That's really, really tough. But you will benefit greatly. And I'm serious about this. Sit down with yourself and ask you, what do I want? If you figure it out, if you're honest, find out what that game is. Learn to play it. Because when you get up there with the big boys, you're going to play the same game they are. It's going to be beneficial if you're better at it than them.
Damn, dude. You're absolutely right. That's deep as shit. I mean, I don't even know how else to remark about that, but it is. Did you ever have a moment or did you ever a minute where you were like, I'm here. I finally did it. Or does your brain not do that? Or is it just, what am I doing at this moment?
Oh, no. No, no, no. Going to LA, making it to KLOS September 8th, 1986. Jesus, that's loud. It'll go off again. September 8th, 1987, I made it to Los Angeles. That was my dream, my goal. I told you guys, that's what I wanted. And I made it, and I was there. And we landed, and we started listening to KLOS. It was my first classic rock radio station. Half of the songs they played, I had never heard in my life. And I listened to the jocks, and they were historians of the music. People treasured it. And I'm looking at Brian and I'm going, okay, wait a minute. Here's a radio station that absolutely, it's a religion for these people. And they hired us to do the morning show. And I very quickly, as I was saying those words in my head, I realized that they did not hire us to come in here and worship this classic rock. They hired us and gave us 100,000 watt FM radio station in Los Angeles and told us to go in there and fuck it up. Go in there and do what we hired you to do. And I told Brian, I said, we're not going to get caught up in any of this. We're going to hit the ground fucking running. We are going to sink or swim, but we're going to do it our way. We're not playing anybody else's game. And that was why I told you day one, Neil Young can suck my dick. I rake that needle across that record. I don't give a fuck what you think about it. This is how I roll. And I knew I made it that moment. That I'll be honest with you, I'll go back night before. I rented a house with my wife and my son in Northridge, and I'm in the jacuzzi. I was in it because I had one and I could do it. And the very next morning was our first show, the very first show. And I'm sitting in the jacuzzi and it hit me. Tomorrow's our first show and nobody from the radio called. Nobody from the station called. Hey, just want to make sure, you know, you remember tomorrow's the show. And then it hit me. Well, wait a minute, dude. You're in Los Angeles, California. You're a pro. Nobody is supposed to call you. Nobody needs to call you. You didn't get here by being a dickhead. You're a pro.
Dickhead.
Kind of got here by being a dickhead. I mean, in some way.
And honestly, it was that moment where I realized this is it. I have worked 15 years nonstop, and this is the moment. I'm doing it tomorrow. And that was it. And then when things really started clicking and rocking, at that point, I never really looked at it and went, oh, wow, we're really good. You're so busy doing it, you don't kind of see it or realize it. But I was aware that at one point, probably around 89 or 90, I knew for a fact that we were the best show in radio anywhere in the world. Nobody was doing what we were doing because we were making shit up as we went. And it was just fucking awesome. And why? Because we meant it. It was sincere. It was honest. It was original. Nobody had a better time than we did doing dumb shit. And it worked.
So what was the deal with you guys and Howard Stern? Because I know there was some weirdness there.
It was all him. Howard's thing, he was syndicated. And Howard was in New York. We were in L.A. And Philadelphia was the first one. And he went in, they put him on the air from New York. He never even went to Philly. And they put him on the air. And the very first thing he did, it was brilliant what he did. It was psychological warfare. He started attacking the number one show, calling them losers. They copied my act. They do everything I do. They're posers. They're this, they're that. It was a psychological attack. And within, God, a month, he was number one in Philly. In every city, he did the same thing. He did exactly that to us. And what made it psychologically brilliant, you know, the fact of the matter is Howard didn't need that tactic. Howard is the best there is. He is the best at, like, I've never heard a better interviewer than him. He gets people to say shit that they wouldn't admit to you privately, but they say it on the air because he's that good. So he didn't need that. But the psychological attack that he brought about was unique in that it not only attacked you with a really good radio show, but it attacked you where you live. Your own staff starts to look at you like, really? You stole his thing? When it's complete bullshit and he knows it. But it worked. And look, guys, another rule you've got to learn in the world of entertainment, you have to know that it's like Andy Warhol said, everybody gets their 15 minutes. If you're lucky enough to make it and make it big, enjoy it. Enjoy it and be great because it's going to be over soon. Because just like you came along, you were fresh and different and new, and people dug it because they had never seen anything like that. After a couple of years, 3 years, 5 years, 10, whatever, they've seen it. And now they're looking for the next new thing. Can't blame them. You got to know that when you step into the world of entertainment, because it's great today, it ain't so great tomorrow because there's somebody new. Know that game, and it doesn't hurt when it happens. Benefit yourself, put the money in the bank, get ready for what's coming. Know the game.
So Old Faithful doesn't apply? You know what I mean? As far as like, there's like, you know, there's the new thing. There's the brand new thing. There's the trending thing. Or you can always go to Old Faithful. This is the stuff that is always solid. This band, this movie maker, Quentin Tarantino, whoever your favorite movie maker is, you know what I mean? Hint, right. I like Quentin all Tarantino. Right. How would you go? What do you think about that?
All right.
Are there people that are going to?
I'll answer your question, Ralph, with perfection. You never know. Because on Mark and Brian, throughout my years, I met a lot of guys in a lot of great bands. Journey, I knew them all. Just so many classic rock bands that were huge. And you know, and we would have them on the show, and they're promoting the gig at the Greek Theater, whatever the case is. And every now and then, one of the bands, like Toto, you know, he would do, we're making a new album. And in my brain, I never said this out loud, but in my brain, I'm thinking, nobody gives a shit about your new record. They want you to go to the Greek and play the hits that you had in the 70s and 80s and shut up about a new record. It's stupid. And I was right. They would make the record. It would be released. Nobody gave a shit. It disappeared. Nobody even knows they did it. And then comes this, Ralph. I would have never believed it. I would have never guessed it. This band made a brand new, and they're classic rock. They're huge, but nobody gives a shit about their new music, but they did it. And their album debuted number one worldwide in the US and in the UK. And this sounds like it was made in 1978. It was made yesterday. And their fucking name is AC fucking DC. Number one. You know what this is? Fuck you. I tell you, I said this on the podcast this morning. If we didn't have COVID, I would get all my people, my kids, their wives and whatever they got. And I would say, okay, look, AC/DC, they're doing the thing. I'm going to get the best seats in the house. We're going, we're going to have a great dinner. We're going to go to the show. And in the middle of AC/DC, I'm going to beat the fuck out of every one of you cocksuckers. Yeah, I've never been. I would love to see AC.
Oh, absolutely, dude. Absolutely.
So look, man, the answer to your question is you don't know. Why? Why does Toto and Journey make a new record? Nobody gives a fuck. AC/DC does it. It's number one. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. Nobody knows. You just got to, I mean, why did they do it? Why did AC/DC bother to do it? Well, they knew something I didn't. I'm shocked by that. So I don't know about old school. I don't know. People dig what, look, I don't do social media. I've got a Twitter account and a Facebook and a whatever the thing is, and I don't do it because I don't think anybody, including me, needs to know that I'm at Starbucks on a Tuesday at 3:48 having a latte. But why does something trend? I'll give you an example. The guy who was on a skateboard drinking, I think, a Dr. Pepper and skateboard.
Cranberry juice.
Okay.
Yeah.
Why did that go worldwide, global fucking crazy? I don't know. I'm old. I don't understand it. It's for you young cocksuckers. No, figure the thing out and put it out there. I don't know. But just, man, you know, with this, with what we're talking about, have fun. If you mean it and you're digging it, do it and enjoy it. And if something good comes, great. But that doesn't mean you can't work it, but dig it and put out the good stuff.
Well, that's the thing too. If you're going to, for me and Ralph, we don't do it for the money, but marketing for me personally is enjoyable. Like if I'm going to make a piece of product, my job, part of that project is getting it out to the people and learning how to market it and brand it and do all this stuff, you know? So it does scratch the itch of, for me, it's like almost like a puzzle or a game for me. You know, it's like, did what I try this time do better? Or did what I try, you know, did it fall short? You know, I remember you said one time when you were doing Mark in the Mornings, because when you were doing Mark in the Mornings, I was driving a truck and hating my life. But I remember you made a point of telling everybody at the show, and you would tell the listeners that whenever you woke up, you would go, and you would encourage, you know, Gina and the rest of them, how could you make the show better for that day?
Mm-hmm.
I cannot tell you from the jump when I started doing this kind of stuff after I got out of that job, to Ralph's credit, I'm one of the people who chose to burn the boats. I have taken that to heart, and it's insane what kind of production and what kind of, not production, progress you make. Just out of that simple one question, because that little questions like that and setting yourself to a standard, whether you're trying to make money or not, makes you something better than you were yesterday, no matter what. And that is the point of, if you're a creative, or even if your job, to what you were saying, find out what you want to do and go with it. Even if that is a bartender, if you wake up and go, how do I be a better bartender today? You're gonna be the best bartender. You're gonna fall. You know, it's the classic, you know, shoot for the moon and reach the stars kind of thing. You know.
Well, you dance across an area. When I was talking to the School of Rock kids, sixth grade to the 12th grade, I was pretty serious as I got into, because I mean this. You've got two dates in your life, and this exemplifies your point, Cody. Ralph, when were you born? What date were you born? 1960.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
No, so, not 1960. No.
All right. So that's number one. There's two dates. There's that one. We know that one. I wrote that down. I'm going to draw a line across the paper. And then we don't know. I put a question mark. We don't know that date because that's the day Ralph is going to die. See this line? Ralph, do you see that line that I drew? Do you see the line? From your birthday.
Yeah, I see it.
That line is your life. And I'm going to put a dit there and a dit there. That life, that line is your life. And, you know, it's the only thing that you own. Only you decide what you do in there. It doesn't matter. I don't care what you think. You decide what you do. And you know what? I don't know what your religious beliefs are. I, for one, think this is the only shot you got. You got that line. Whatever you do or don't do is up to you. I have a fear. I don't have the fear anymore, but I did. And my fear is this. I'm sitting in a rocking chair when I'm 80 and I'm looking back at my line. And I'm thinking, God, if I'd really given it everything, I could have made it. I could have done it. I don't have that fear anymore. I did give it everything I had. And I succeeded. I got what I wanted. I completed my line. I filled it in. And now it's gravy. I just sit around jerking off. Looking at the lake, I got ducks. It's good. It's sweet. But I'm complete. That biggest fear, I don't have to worry. I filled in my line. You have to make a decision in your life. And listen, I get it. I get why I brought up the point. You got to pay the bills while you chase whatever it is that you want to do. You have to do that. You know, you may have a significant other. Tell your significant other your plan. What do you want? Figure it out. Pay the bills. Get your thing done. Fulfill your line. Make it worthwhile. Don't sit in that rocking chair and say to yourself, I could have done it, but I didn't. So that's the whole point of the whole fucking thing, man. The line. What are you putting on yours?
That's
Great advice.
I don't even that is one thing. If everybody could sink that in, it does. Like I said, you're absolutely right. It doesn't matter what you're doing it for either. It doesn't have to be creative. It doesn't have to be anything. My father brought stuff like that up to me since I was a baby, and conversely, you too. I mean, I learned a lot from you when I was growing up because of your show and your art. And that is,
well, my father, he and I did not get along. Mm-hmm. For the record, he was hardcore. My father was a bank president, highly educated. He wanted a mini me. He wanted the same thing from me, get a college degree, sitting in an office with a tie on. And it wasn't my thing. It wasn't my bag. And I shunned it early on, even though I didn't know what I wanted to do. But I learned a couple of things from him. He once said, making a decision is easy. Living with it is hard. But the one that I'm going to bring up here, and even though I don't think I listened to it at the time, I learned it because I still think about it. I was doing my homework. I was 10. I was doing my homework, and it must have been really sloppy, the writing on the paper. And my father walked by, and he goes, "What's that?" And I said, "It's my homework. I'm finishing up my homework." And he goes, "Well, I notice up here on the top right corner, you haven't signed your name yet so that they know who did it." He goes, and I went, "Well, yeah, I'll finish and then I'll put my name up there." And he goes, "You know what it means when you sign your name up there in the top right?" I said, "Well, no, what bullshit are you going to say to me now?" And he said, "When you put your name up there, you're telling the person who's going to read it that this on this piece of paper is the absolute best you can do. Have a good day." And he walked away. I signed my fucking name to that pile of shit. I'm not going to recopy that bullshit, but he was correct. He was absolutely correct. And I've never forgotten it. So even though I didn't respond to it at the time, I learned it. And that goes in when you check in, for a show and you go on stage. Look, I can't tell you how many radio shows I did when I felt like shit, but I did them because I'm insane. You think about radio, especially at like a top jock, a number one, there's millions of people that listen to this jock and he or she is entertaining millions and millions of people. What you don't realize is that this person is certifiably insane because this jock is sitting in a little bitty room somewhere completely alone. He's by himself. But he's entertaining millions of people. You got to be a little fucking baddie to be able to do that. So, it is what it is. But I do think that, you know, you have to respect people's time. And when the show is at 9 and you don't feel great, fuck you. Get out and give it everything you've got. These people spent their money, drove 50 miles to come see whatever it is you're going to do. They may not know your name. They may not know the name of the band. How many times have you been to see somebody that you didn't know who the fuck they were? Could be a comedian, could be a rock band, and they blew you away. Mm. Do that to them. You may not feel great. I didn't, but I still put on a great show. You owe that. You owe that to them. They gave you time. They gave you money. Give them a goddamn show.
Yeah. Sometimes you just gotta put on those nipple clamps and just buzz away. No, I'm sorry. No, but I get what you're saying. Your dad, even though you guys didn't get along, he taught you a valuable lesson in work ethic.
Many. He really did. Great. And I took those with me. And I think there's a lot of good life lessons in there. Now, don't get me wrong. Fucked up dude. That guy absolutely. But, you know, I think he was a dichotomy of everybody in that we all have some really good sides and some not so good.
Right.
Yeah. And you know, I try to work on mine that are not so great. I am real big about owning your own shit.
Yeah.
I can't stand victims. You know, I got fired in that job, you know, I was doing great, but they didn't. I don't know. They just didn't like me or something personal. And meanwhile, you realize the guy's a fucking loser. He never showed up. He was a pig. You got to own your shit because only when you own it, like when you fuck up, you got to say, It's on me. I fucked up. Only when you admit to yourself that you fucked up, do you learn. I can't do that again. I fucked up. Don't blame it on somebody else. Own it if it's you. Own it, learn from it, and don't do it again. Mistakes are the best thing that ever happened anywhere in the world.
That's true, because I remember reading an interview with I remember reading a scientific study. I told Ralph about this a while ago. They took these computer guys took their first level of the original Super Mario Brothers game, and they reprogrammed it to where you didn't have to do anything. You just watch it run across the screen. And then they took a control group, they put them in the room and let them play the game like normal. And then they took the other group and let them play this new version of the game. People play the new version of a game, as you can imagine, play for about 5 fucking minutes. And they're like, this is stupid. It's just running. And then the guys who had the original game played for, it's fucking Mario Brothers, however long it takes to play the game. The point being is, if you don't have to do anything, if there aren't mistakes, oh, shit. Start it, because that's how I do. Now try to remember what the hell I was saying, because I was making a big old point, and then we got lost because I'm stupid. Oh, anyways. No, they made the game. The point with all of the game stuff being is that if you don't have the pitfalls, if you don't have the fuck-ups where you sometimes, I remember when I was a kid playing that game, I would walk off the corner and go, why did you just do that? That might have been the dumbest thing you've ever fucking done. Without those, though, in anything you do, what's the fucking point, dude? Where's the greatness? Where's the fun of it? If you don't set out to have those experiences of embarrassment or shame or whatever people want to associate with them, really, what's the fucking point? To look back and go, it was super easy. I did absolutely nothing.
Well, my wife told me something I didn't know. It was when the sound had reached out about doing Mark in the Morning and did I want to do it? And we were talking about that. And she was kind of asking, why are you doing this? You've worked all your life. Why do you want to do this? What's the point for you? And I said, I want to do it because I want to. I'm not quite done. I want to do a show on my own and make a statement with that. And she didn't say anything for a bit. And then she said, do you know how lucky you are? And I said, well, it depends on your point, but yeah, I do. And she said, no, you're lucky because you know what you want to do. I thought, honestly, I thought everybody did. I thought everybody just, because when I got hit with the white hot spotlight idea of being on the radio, everything else disappeared. Nothing else mattered it to me. And I thought that's the way it was with everybody. I was unaware that some people just don't know what they want. And I don't know what to say to them. I feel bad for people that are stuck in jobs they hate. But if you don't know what you want to do, that's sad. That's not fair. Everybody should know. You should know. It should be fair that you know. But if you don't, I'm sorry.
Yeah, sometimes you just got to figure it out, I think. I think a lot of people have options, right? That's a good question, I guess. Mark, did you have other options, career options that you could go?
Not really. I knew really, really quickly that for me, a degree, if my life was going to be dictated by how good a student I was, I am fucked. Because I'm sitting there and I knew at a very early age that I am never going to need to know the year and the date that Ponce de Leon landed in Florida. And so I just kind of didn't get, look, I'm not bagging education, but I just knew that this wasn't going to lead me personally anywhere. Had it not been for radio, I really honestly do believe I would have worked over there at Reynolds Aluminum, making good money and not being happy. And my son went to the Baseball Hall of Fame with a friend. He went on vacation with his friend. And they're going through the style the ticket style there at the Baseball Hall of Fame, and the guy was taking tickets, and my son looked at him and said, "How you doing?" And he goes, "Drinking as much as I can, waiting to die." And I guess he was kidding, but maybe he wasn't. For a lot of people, that's kind of it. You clock in and clock out. And I find that really, really sad. I hope that's not the case. I hope everybody knows exactly what they want and they chase it. But I know that real life, you know, pops in there and slaps you around pretty good. I do believe very strongly in, you know, get up, dust yourself off and go at it again. Because real life, I don't care who you are. It's coming. It's coming and it's coming hard. And just know when it does, you're not the only one. Everybody gets slapped. And I'm a big believer. Every time I've gotten slapped, the number one thing I do is attack it right away. The problem is not going to go away. Right. Attack it right now, this second, get up and start the first thing at getting rid of this problem. Whatever it is, attack it, do it, move on for the next one because it's coming.
Yeah,
that's wild. Yeah, that's,
I think, true. A lot of people get caught up in the rat race of just trying to survive, and they lose sight of what's important. I'll be honest.
No, I know,
and that's rough. I am one of the people that you were just referring to. I mean, I was in a position where I thought, oh, I'm never gonna make anything out of myself, so I'll just go and get a job and fuck it. And quite honestly, it damn near killed me. I mean, it is not a good place to be. But I think you're right. I think the only way out of that is to focus on what makes you whole, what makes things important to you, and then you claw and fight and bite your way to that spot. You have to. I think it's a rite of passage for all of us to do. It's the hardest fucking answer we ever have to come up with. Who are you and what makes you you? But once you find it, it's undeniable. You got to go for it.
Well, I also think that there's a lot of people that are perfectly happy and perfectly fine to work at the Ralphs, and they're good. And you know, like I say, it may be that your thing is you just want to have kids and work at Ralphs and whatever. And I don't judge any of that. If you're happy, if you're good,
right.
There are certain, my thing is just figure out what it is that you want and go get that. You can have pretty much anything if you put your mind to it and you stay nose to the grindstone. But if it's not your thing, it's not your thing.
But you got to be honest too, because there's a lot of people, I think, who like the idea, like in bands and showbiz, a lot of times they like the idea of being in it and they won't be true to themselves and go, this ain't for me. I'm just not feeling this. You know, and I think some people will get caught up in the rat race and turn creation and art into a job they hate because they just don't like it. You know,
it was in that documentary Hired Gun. This one guy, he was in a band. I think they were, I forget, but I think they were mediocrely successful. And he was kind of thinking that he was, you know, a part of a member of the family. And the leader of the, he had mentioned it to the leader of the band, the singer and the guy that wrote it. And he goes, wait, let me explain something to you. You are just a musician. You get paid. You're not a member of the family. If you want that, go write your own music, go sing your own music, go write your own ticket. You're just a hired gun here. And he said about a week after that, I was on stage and I realized I just don't fucking love this. I just am not digging this. I'm done. And he quit and he made ends meet for a while. And then he landed into something that he had always wanted to try because he happened to be gifted with a great voice. He's now a top voiceover artist.
Oh,
and so, yeah. And he chased after what he wanted. He didn't want to be on stage anymore. He was honest with himself. He realized that. And then he went and chased after what he wanted. And now he's big. He's like huge.
That's crazy.
So what are you working on now, Mark? What's your current projects ahead? Can you talk about them?
Yeah, one of them I can't, but I'm really, really, really retired. I'm looking forward to this pandemic being over. I want desperately to hug and see my kids in California. I want grandkids more than anything. I've already figured out where in my yard the swing set goes and some stuff I'm going to do down to the beach. I want to do some writing. I'm not a bad writer. I love painting. I love to go out there. Usually I have two or three paintings going. And, you know, for me, I just enjoy that. I get an idea of what I want to paint and I start, and I just want it to turn out well. I enjoy mixing paint to get the right texture and the right color. And I've learned a lot by fucking up everything. I'm enjoying, like, I just got a puppy. He's a golden doodle, 10 pounds, the cutest fucking thing. And we live on the lake, and I took him out to the bathroom one day and he heard something. It was a crane. And that's one of the great things about lake living, is the lake life. And so he wanted to know more about that. So the cranes, every morning about 6:30, they conjure down at the left end of the cove. And within some amount of time, they start swimming and squawking. And that was what he heard. So I ran him down there one morning. There was about 50 of them. And right when they got to us, they took off flying over us, 50 cranes squawking. And he looked at me like, what the fuck is that? I love watching lake life. Here's something you couldn't know. Why would you know? In the spring, the ducks have babies and the geese have babies. In the duck world, mom is in front. The babies line up in a straight line behind her. The dad, which, by the way, ducks mate for life. The dad will keep the ducklings in line. If one moves out of the line, he puts his beak on them and pushes them back. This one duckling kept getting out of line. The dad would move him back and then move him back and then move him back. The fourth time he got out, the father just popped him with his beak and he got back in line. The geese, the dad is not there. They do not mate for life. The goose mother swims and her gooselings swim a circle around her as they move. These things I know because I live on the lake.
That's a great way to end this.
And the moral of the story is, the moral of the story is, he knows this because he lives on the lake.
Well, I guess the whole point is you are now bearing the fruits of your labor. No, he's absolutely right. He's bearing the fruits of his labor, man. He worked hard. He had a great work ethic. He went after what he wanted to do and he made it. And now look at him. He's talking about geese and ducks.
Well,
nobody's going to tell him to stop.
I will tell you this. I packed my Monte Carlo 1977. With everything I could fit in it. And I left my mother, father, and sister waving goodbye in the driveway. And I took off on this adventure, not knowing where it was going to go, which was part of the fun. And I moved 16 times, 16 different cities, packed a U-Haul and took off to the next job. That's the only way to climb the ladder to get to where I wanted to get to. And I made it where I wanted to go. And that's over with. I got to tell you, the destination was great. Loved the destination, but it was the road. It was the travel. It was the experience. It was the adventure. That was the gift. I can't tell you how many times I think about the different shit that I ran into and this and that, but it's what they say. It's never the destination. It's always the ride. So enjoy yours.
Mark Thompson, you truly are the radio god, sir. I cannot thank you enough for giving us your time.
Thank you, Cody. Thank you, Ralph.
Thank you,
Mark. And I think, honestly, and all joking aside, the moral really is you have to be in the rat race and enjoy the ride so you can enjoy the fucking swan swimming in circles on the lake later.
Absolutely.
It ties in, man. I'm telling you, I can sell it.
Yeah, go with it, baby. Go with it.
Mark, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thanks, Mark. Hopefully we'll get to talk to you soon again. Are you doing a podcast with your wife?
Yeah, every Friday. I did it this morning from 11 till 12:30 Eastern. It's the Mark and Linda podcast. It's up there. You'll enjoy it. I throw out just dumb shit, just having a good time.
M&L and where's Studios. It on? Oh, okay. Can we catch it on Spotify or
everywhere? Spotify, oh, iTunes. YouTube. Yeah, okay. Mark and Linda with a Y.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. Awesome. You heard it, guys. Go check it out.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Mark.
Every Friday.
It's great talking to you, bro.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, sir.